Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your goodness and your mercy and your loving kindness. We thank you, Father, that you brought every one of us back here tonight safely, just because you're so good, Lord Jesus, and that you are watching over every one of us. Lord, you sent your angels to take care of us, to watch over us and to keep us, Father. Father, we thank you that you keep us in your loving kindness and your tender mercies. And right now, Lord Jesus, we just thank you that you are with Pastor Mark and Pastor Ann and Elizabeth. Lord Jesus, as they are risking their lives to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ in Nepal. Right now, Father, we just thank you. We thank you, Father, for protecting them, for being all around them, for anointing them and empowering them and quickening them by the Holy Spirit. Father, rivers of living water flowing out, Father. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Father, for great awakening in Nepal. We thank you, Father, for great awakening in Nepal, in southern Nepal. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we thank you that you are equipping, Father, the saints, the pastors, the ministers, the leaders of Nepal, Father, to go forth and mightily proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ with signs and wonders and miracles by your holy child, Jesus. Hallelujah. We thank you, Father, for victory in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus, for shaking that nation, Father, the southern part of that nation, just like you did in Kathmandu in 2008, Father, that the glory is still being seen and revealed to this day, God, that the move of the Spirit that was there, Father, the mighty outpouring, the great awakening, Father, that happened in 2008, Father, that today in southern Nepal, that same glory, Father, and even greater, Father, that it even spill out into northern India and shake India with the glory of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Father, for setting Nepal and India on fire for Jesus. We thank you, Father, for the multitudes of the souls coming into the kingdom in the mighty name of Jesus. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Father God, that there's just such an increase, Father, that your word go forth mightily. Father, it be sounded out through the nations, oh God. Father, bring in the harvest. Father, we thank you. We thank you, Father, for raising up the laborers, Father, that will stand and declare your word with all boldness. Father, that will be full gospel people, fully believing your word, fully standing upon your promises, living out your word, walking it out, and seeing your glory revealed in the nations of the earth today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to your name, Lord. And we just thank you, Father, for what you're doing in South Korea, Father, an increase of the glory. Father, awakening among those that have become complacent. Father, a mighty outpouring in South Korea, a mighty outpouring of your Holy Spirit in North Korea. And Father, we just pray for all those that are laboring in the kingdom in North Korea, Father, that are being tortured for the glory of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We ask you, Father, to send to deliverance, Father, and let their voice be heard on high. Father, let their voice be heard throughout North Korea. Father, we ask you to turn that nation. We ask you to turn that nation, Father, from the leadership all the way down to the very last person. Father, awakening to your glory, awaken to your righteousness. Oh, Father, let North Korea once again be the Jerusalem of the East, Father, where your glory is revealed. Yes, Lord Jesus, we thank you, Father. We thank you for the souls that are in that nation, that they come to you. Father, we claim their souls for the kingdom of heaven right now, and we bid them to come in Jesus' name. Father, we just break off the hindrances and the lies of the enemy and the powers of darkness that have gripped that nation, and we speak freedom and liberty, 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 liberty now in Jesus' name. Liberty now in Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus. We thank you, Father. Hallelujah. And Father, go prepare the way in Japan. Father, send forth your messengers to prepare the way in Japan. Father, make the path straight. Father, let your glory be revealed in Japan. Father, we thank you for the nation of Japan. Father, being a Christian nation, shake Japan, Father, the very foundation of Japan. Father, break off religion from Japan now in Jesus' name. Father, great awakening, great awakening, great awakening in Japan. Father, we thank you for a great awakening in Japan. We thank you, Jesus, that it no more be 1%, but it be one of the leading Christian nations around the world in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise you, Father, for the nations of the world. Father, we thank you that you give us the heathen for our inheritance. All we have to do is ask, believe, receive, and do what you have called us to do. And Father, we can have the heathen for our inheritance. Hallelujah. Oh, glory to your name, Lord Jesus. Glory to your name. Father, I just thank you for this earth-shaking church, Father, that you have planted right here in San Diego, California. And Father, I thank you for every person that you brought into this place. Lord Jesus, I ask you to touch them by your mighty power. Father, make every one of them an earth-shaking history maker. In Jesus' name, showing forth the glory of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Not one of us be willing to be left out. But every one of us saying, here I am, Lord. Here I am, Jesus. Here I am, Lord. Send me. Use me. Father, equip me. Father, put your word in my mouth. Father, give me boldness. Father, we thank you, Lord. We cry right now. We ask you to give us boldness to declare your word. Give us boldness, Father, to speak your word with all authority and power. And Father, we thank you for signs following as we each one go and we declare your word. Father, for signs following as we speak your word. Father, your glory being revealed, your glory being seen upon us. Oh, Father God, may we stay in your presence until you are so seen in us, Father, that we change the very atmosphere of the place that we step into. Lord, when we walk into a place, Father, the very atmosphere is changed because we are present, because we carry the glory of heaven within us. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Almighty God. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you. I thank you, Father, for the Holy Ghost and fire that endues us with the power to be the witness, to be the witness, to be your witness, one you're proud of, one you're happy about, not mealy mouth church mouses, but powerful, Holy Ghost filled, equipped saints of the Most High God, heirs and joint heirs with Jesus Christ, ambassadors of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Hallelujah. Oh, Father, may we live in this divine power and authority and glory that you have given us. Who? You, Jesus. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you, Father, that we live in it, that we walk in it, that we talk it. Father, that it is all that is on our mind is heaven. And the things of heaven being done here on earth, your kingdom coming to earth, your will being done in earth, not only in our life, but Father, first in our life, first in our life, that it can spill out of us, Lord Jesus. It's not about a ministry. It's about a relationship and a fellowship. And we thank you, Father, for this great fellowship. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to your name, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Glory and honor to your name. Oh, bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless your holy name. Oh, Lord Jesus, we will forget not all your many benefits. We will not forget your many benefits. We will not forget your many benefits. Oh, hallelujah. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Hallelujah. We will not forget his many benefits. Oh, Jesus, who forgiveth all of our iniquities, who heals all of our diseases, all of them, all of them. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Our sins, our mistakes, our failures, they are cast into the sea of forgetfulness. They are put out as far as the east is from the west. Father does not remember them anymore. So if Father doesn't remember them anymore, you shouldn't let the enemy bring them up and tell you anything about them. Because that's done, it's over with. The blood has washed it whiter than snow. You don't go back there and dig up the past. You don't let the enemy dig up the past. You are living in today. You are living in today and you're moving into the future. God's always a God of the present and the future. He's not a God that lives in the past to go back over and over people's failures. He's a God that forgets. It's his desire. He said, though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. He just said, come on, come on, come on, let us reason together. Though you're in a miserable state, though you have defiled yourselves, though you have been the most wicked people on the planet, come to me, come and let us reason together. I have your answer. I have your answer. Though your sins are as scarlet, they shall be made white as snow. White as snow. Hallelujah. 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 This is the living God we serve. This is the living God that we serve. One that holds nothing against us. He says, though your sins be many, they are forgiven. They are forgiven. His only request is, I've set you free. I've set you free. Now go and sin no more. Go and sin no more. Sin no more. Sin no more. Sin no more. Go, because I've set you free. Live your life in freedom. Why live your life in bondage when you can live your life in freedom? Amen? Amen. Why will people continue to go back to the dog's vomit? Or to the pig wallowing in the mud? Why go back to that when he has set us free, completely free from every power of darkness? And we can live and dwell in that. It is so easy. It is so easy. And again, as we are, some of us are babes. Some people that have come into this place, they're babies. And you just desire the sincere milk of the word that you may grow thereby. You're growing up. You know, you start out as a baby and you grow up. And some people stay babies for about 10 years. And, you know, God's merciful. He's good. Some people stay babies for 20 years. Some people grow up in 3 years. But, you know, there's just a difference. In the hunger. But, you know, as long as you say, I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord. And you just humble yourself. You just humble yourself before God. And you say, I cannot do it on my own. Amen. I am nothing of myself. I'm nothing. I'm nothing. I have nothing to say. I am nothing. I don't want to be anything outside of him. I can accomplish nothing outside of him. It is him and me, and that is it. That is all there is right here in this vessel. And as long as we walk humbly before God, he will take us and he will use us for his glory and his honor. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that awesome? We serve a mighty God. We serve a loving Father. He loves us so much. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's nobody that has to leave feeling left out or unable or ill-equipped. You have the Holy Ghost. You just come and you just worship him and you praise him. You don't ever have to get into the depths of depression or despair. You don't ever have to lean upon your own understanding. You don't ever have to walk it out on your own. You don't ever have to do anything by yourself. You're just leaning on Jesus. Leaning on Jesus. Leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, what a fellowship. Oh, what a glory divine. Leaning, just leaning on Jesus. Leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, hallelujah. This is glorious. This is a glorious fellowship, a glorious salvation. Hallelujah, Jesus. We praise you, Father. We thank you, Father. Oh, hallelujah. Father, we thank you for the sweet presence of the Holy Spirit that is in this place. Oh, thank you, Jesus, for your glory. You know, some of you guys just sit there like sunbeams just in the glory. If I stare at you while I'm ministering, it's because you're just lit up with the glory of God, and I just get drawn over to that. Because, you know, when we hunger, when we put a demand on the anointing, the Holy Spirit comes, and he ministers to us. So those that are coming in here like a sponge, getting filled up, getting soggy, ready to be wrung out with the glory and the rain of heaven. Ah, the glory just shines on you. You sit there in the glory, you just like a little sunbeam. And I'm up here ministering, and I find myself leaning towards that direction where the glory's coming out, you know, just meets, you know, that expectation, that demand put on the anointing. And then the Holy Spirit is going to come and he's going to minister to that need. He's going to answer. He's going to answer that need. It's amazing. So many times, you know, instead of going to counseling, I went to the Father. And when it would take a little bit to get that answer, and I'd be really pressing in to get that answer, you know, so many times it comes so quickly. You know, the Lord just answers you immediately. But there's times where you're waiting on the answer. You're waiting on God. You're waiting on God to speak to you. And so I come to church and I'm like, okay, Father, you know, here is where my answer is. I came to meet with you and I came to get this answer. Father, I need this answer. There's times that I have been desperate for an answer because I, you know, young and immature in the Lord, and I didn't know how to go through this battle. I didn't know how to walk it out. And so I came into the house of the Lord. I came to meet with the Father. And I said, Father, here is the need. Here's where I'm at. Here's what's going on, and I need to hear from you. And that's why I sit there and say, yes, Father. Yes, Lord. I don't say, yes, Pastor so-and-so or whoever. I say, thank you, Father. Lord, I thank you. Yeah, I heard that, Father. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. I heard you, Father. Yes, Lord. Come and feed me more. More. Because that's what he's doing. He's here using a vessel. I'm only a vessel. You can't look to me. I'm not your answer, Jesus is, but I am willing to let him use me. And all you need to do is be willing to let him use you, and it's amazing what he will do. You always get blown away. You always step back and go, oh, Father, you are amazing, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, God, you're so good. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Father. Oh, thank you, Father, that you take vessels of clay and you make them vessels of honor. For your glory. For your glory. For all eternity. Oh, Lord, and you're so patient with us. And help us to be patient with ourselves as we're walking out this fellowship and relationship. Oh, Father God, I thank you, Father, for touching the lives and the hearts of those that have seen hypocrisy and have been discouraged by hypocrisy. Father, I pray right now in Jesus' name that they don't put their eyes on people. They don't put their eyes on men. They don't look to people to satisfy them, but they look to Jesus. And you alone. You alone. You alone, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Father, that from this day forward, they will no longer look and justify their situation even because of what men have done, but they will look to Jesus and see the cross, the perfect cross, by the redeeming Savior that was a lamb without spot or blemish for us. That is our example. And if we follow that, then men can look at us. As long as we follow that, we can be like Paul and say, follow me as I follow Christ. But if we're not full gospel Christians, if we're picking and choosing and tearing out the pages, basically, might as well tear them out literally. I think some of these people that don't preach the full gospel ought to just cut it all out of their Bible. And then they could come with, you know, the outside of their Bible, because there ain't nothing left. There's not very much left. I mean, like I said that one time, is you could read the names in Matthew and try not to get under the anointing. But if you know what's going on when you read the list of the genealogy, if you know what's going on and you know how God took Rahab out of Jericho and everybody else was destroyed, but the harlot believed God. I mean, doesn't God pick them good? The harlot believed God. And she was accounted in that number of the genealogy. Now look at that. She was accounted in the line of the Messiah because she believed God. God brought her out. She ended up marrying royalty in Israel and was accounted in the lineup of the Messiah. And then we've got Ruth. No hope. No hope for them. Noah's descendants that messed up bad that Israel would have nothing to do with. The cast off. Israel was have nothing to do with them. And then she was found faithful before God. Her husband wasn't found too faithful. And that was the end of him. But she was found faithful. And she went on with Naomi and she said, I will not depart from you. Because she found a fellowship and a relationship with God through Naomi, because Naomi was faithful to God. And then God brings Ruth into the land of Israel and she marries the royalty Boaz, and she had Obed, which was the father of Jesse, which was the father of David. Now see, you can just get shouting in the glory over the names that are written in the genealogy. So I don't know how people stay out of the glory. It's beyond me. I don't know how they stay out of the full gospel when they can look and see what Jesus does? The glory of the Father with what he will do with you. He will take you out of your garbage and out of your filth and out of your quagmire, and he will set you up on high. It doesn't matter what you have done. People need to stop staying stuck in what they've done in the past and who they were. You need to forget about everything that isn't today. And you need to say, Father, today, what are you doing with me? What is your purpose and your plan with me? I don't care how old you were. Moses was 80 years old when he went before the burning bush, when he finally turned to see that glory. He was 80 years old, so I don't care how old you are. If you just say, here I am, Lord, use me, Lord. I'm going to forget about everything that's past. You guys can sit down. I'm preaching. I'm going to forget about everything that's past, and I'm going to move in to the realms of your glory. I'm going to move on in to the realms of your presence. Of course, it was wonderful with you up here. I don't want to insult anybody. We love every one of you. You guys were helping me preach, standing there behind me. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, what an amazing God. Oh, what an amazing God that loves us so much. And he don't care. He don't care who you were or what you were. He's not interested in that. He's interested in what he can make you be. How he can cause you to come on over into this realm of relationship and covenant and fellowship. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, praise you, Father. I am so excited to be here tonight with the saints of God. It's so often awesome to come together in unity, in fellowship, and be strengthened by the fellowship of each person in this place that is reaching out to touch God. That's why we're here. We're not here because it is Sunday night only. We are here because we came to get strengthened by the power, the presence of the Holy Spirit, to come to know him in a deeper way, to come and present our needs and our situations before him, to come to that place that every day and every moment our joy might be full in him, because that's what he came for. He came to make our joy complete and full, that we live in the realms of joy. We live in the realms of glory. He didn't say, come unto me and I'll beat you up good. He said, come unto me, all ye that are heavy laden. Come unto me and find rest for your souls. Not hardship, not labor, not a tough time, but rest. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I think Elsa needs some help if somebody feels the anointing to help her out. That would be amazing. It'd be a blessing to her. She would be able to plug in. We've got this little room right over here that you could go and fellowship and minister to them. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Elsa needs to be able to have a time of refreshing. And the babies, they just need to be touched by the realms of the glory and the anointing. So somebody full of the Holy Ghost and fire that can minister to them, that would be awesome. You know, we're equipped, endued with power to minister to even the kids. We were praying for Bethany's little baby Wednesday night up here, and he was just like still. He couldn't even move. He was captivated. And next thing you know, he just almost falls out of her arms. He just totally turns into a dish rag. The glory of God. I mean, that little baby, he's hooked up. Bethany has kept him in the presence of the Lord. She's seeking after God. She's so hungry. She's so desperate for the Lord. And the Lord, you know, that passes on to your children. That affects your children. That affects the people around you. What you do in your life affects those around you, and especially your children. If you're caught up in the realms of glory, we were just talking about you, Bethany. If you're caught up in the realms of glory, your children are going to be caught up in the realms of glory. Hallelujah. If you're caught up in the realms of sin, you open these big, huge doors, and it comes up like a floodgate straight to your children. And you think, you know, it doesn't hit them when they're little bitty babies. Yeah, it does. It even affects them in the womb. It affects them their entire life. You are the keeper. You are the keeper of your home. And young men that aren't married, young women that aren't married, you want to marry a good man that's going to be a doorkeeper in the house of the Lord. He's not going to allow any ungodliness into your home. He's going to keep it and guard it. And you want to marry a woman that's going to train up your children in the way of the Lord, because she's going to spend probably the most of the time with them, unless you become Mr. Mom, which is a little different, but anyway, because it's not how God made it. But, you know, we just thank the Lord for whatever happens. God's good. But you want to marry a person that is in love with Jesus, that their heart's desire is to raise up your children to serve the Lord. And not in religion, not in I've got it here in head knowledge. You know, there's people that sat in church for 20 years and all they got is a bunch of head knowledge. It has never sunk to here. It hasn't got here. Because when it gets here, when it's here, it's relationship and fellowship, and you are compelled to be in His presence. You can't go a day without Him. You cannot go without His presence. You can't go without His glory. You're pressing in to touch heaven and to see Him. I mean, there is a time where people, you know, get busy, get caught up, and they kind of lose sight of their first love, and they need to repent and come back. But that's a continual thing that we must do, is stay in that realm of that first love relationship, never going out. Never going out, staying there continually, letting that fire be stirred up. And that's relationship before ministry. Ministry is down the line. I said that before, and people need to get a hold of that. It is first, love the Lord your God with all of your heart, your soul, your mind, and your strength. First, out of that relationship and fellowship, Father can use you. Otherwise, you'll find yourself ill-equipped for the battle if you get out there, because Satan will come out to fight you. If you go and you minister to people, the enemy will come out to fight you, to resist you, and you will not be fortified to stand. But you will be affected by that and taken out and be just like the rest of the sinners in the earth when you're supposed to be preaching the gospel and be the light of the gospel of Jesus Christ. People get saved and they go into ministry. And they get caught up in ministry and they feel the anointing of God, because God's word will not return void, but it will go forth and do that thing that He's wants it to do, what he has said that it will do. It will accomplish that. And so they get caught up in what they feel in ministry, and they go so far from relationship, they don't focus on their relationship with God, and then the enemy comes in and takes them out. You want to be fortified in your fellowship and your relationship with God, number one. It's all about you and Jesus. Can you have revival if you're dropped off in the middle of nowhere? If you were dropped off in the wilderness and there was nobody to preach to, can you have revival, just you and Jesus? Can you live in the realms of glory? That's where it is. That first. And then family next. And then ministry after family. Isn't that amazing? So many people put ministry before family. Well, if you do, I was raised with grew up with a lot of ministers' children. We traveled all over, and my father was an evangelist, so we ministered all over, and we had a lot of friends, the minister's children that traveled with my father or that knew my father. We went to their church, and when the father's ministry was their priority, their children were a disaster. They were a wreck. They were a train wreck, you know, and It breaks my heart to see how their lives turned out. An absolute mess, because their parents weren't focused on reaching their household. Number one, being the priest first of the home and then ministering to the rest of the people. You know, God give you those children to raise up. You're responsible, number one, for them. After yourself, after getting yourself in line, your children in line. Teaching them the Word of God, putting the Word of God in them. And so, you know, I had close friends of mine that they were dead before they ever reached 40 due to the ungodliness that they were involved in. And, you know, that's heart-rending. You know, their family's just a mess. The children don't serve God. But if you will do it in order and walk it out right, God is faithful. Hallelujah. And I thank the Lord for my parents that were faithful to the kingdom of God and for their children that serve the Lord. It's a great testimony to the kingdom when your children serve Jesus. Well, I think we're going to go over here into Matthew chapter 8. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Father, for your word that will not return void. Praise you, Jesus. Whew, God is good. And we'll just start in verse 14. We'll start here. And when Jesus had come into Peter's house, he saw his wife's mother, laid and sick with a fever. Now, Peter's mother had already come into relationship and fellowship with Jesus because Peter was a disciple, and he went and told his family, got his family all straightened out, believe me. And Jesus comes in, and he touched her, but she was sick with a fever. So it doesn't say that we are not going to get sick, but like in Psalms 103, he forgives our iniquities, he heals our diseases. Just as if we can believe God to forgive our sins, we can believe God to heal our body. Amen. Amen. And we can take it all the way till we walk in the divine nature and walk in divine healing. We're healing where we don't have sickness and disease. Amen. But we speak that out. We claim that. We don't come in a place of fear and doubt. We stand on the word of God regardless of what we see. We stand upon the word of God. We thank you, Jesus. And so he touched her hand, and the fever instantly left her. How many has experienced that before? When you've had a fever, amen, hallelujah, and you were touched by the presence of God, and instantly that fever left, and instantly you were healed by the power of God. I've experienced that a lot in my life. For some reason, I think I got every childhood disease there was, every sickness, there was just something went on, and I ended up getting it. But I knew where to go. And as soon as, I would say, Daddy, why didn't you come pray for me? He goes, I was waiting for you to call me because it ain't going to do no good. And it isn't going to do a lot of good while you're sitting there feeling sorry for yourself. And as long as you're in the mode of feeling sorry for yourself and wanting people to come on, along and baby you and take care of you and feel bad for you because you feel bad, then it's not going to help you a lot. But when you call out and you're done, when you are done with your sickness, then I'll come pray for you. So he waited. He wouldn't come pray for us until we called him. And we'd call him, he'd come pray for us, and we'd get healed. Because that's what the Bible says. If there's any sick among you, let them call for the elders of church. And let them lay their hands on them. And they will be healed. So thank you, Jesus. The word of God is true. And I don't care what happens, what it looks like, the seeing of the eye, we will stand in the word of God. We will stand in the truth. We will believe what the word of God says, and we will not believe what man says. But every time that we have a situation going on and the enemy comes out with any of his confusion or any of his doubt, we will run to the word. We will run to the rock Christ Jesus. We will fill ourselves up with the word of God and stand in the word. Because things come out against us, and we need to be fortified by what the word of God says. And he touched her hand, and the fever left her, and she arose, and immediately she went from fever, sick, to ministering to them, taking care of their needs. Probably she cooked them dinner. And so she went from sick to cooking dinner. So that's healed. Amen? When the evening was come, they brought unto him many that were possessed with devils. And he cast out the spirits with his word, and he healed all that were sick. All the sick. Again and again, it says in the scripture that he healed all those that came to him. All we have to do is come to Jesus. Not only with sickness, but with sin. With whatever we have that would separate us from the Father. We just come to Jesus and that healing balm is there. We don't ever have to stand outside the gate because we made a mistake. We don't have to stand outside the gate because we get sick. We can always come in and say, here I am, Father. I got myself into this situation, and I thank you, Father, for your healing. You know, and in James it says, if they've committed any sin, it shall be forgiven them. It doesn't say they committed sin, so they're sick because they committed sin. It says if they've committed any sin, because, you know, sometimes sickness comes and it's not because they committed sin. And, you know, we have the example of Paul's companion that worked himself into being sick, and Paul had to leave him sick and go on in the ministry. But thank God he was healed. We have that example too. He didn't die, he was healed. You know, and we look at all the disciples. There were 12 disciples, okay? Judas, he's out. Got another one in there in his place. But all the disciples died, none of them from sickness. They died a martyr's death. You know, and you can look that up. You can look and see how every one of them died a martyr's death. And I think it was Thomas, you know, Doubting Thomas. He died a death, and I believe he, you know, I haven't read that in a while, but I believe Thomas was in India, and they shot him with spears, one right after another, until he died. And I believe that's the way Thomas died. So, you know, the doubting was completely put away once the fire of the Holy Ghost came upon him. You know, and we could say Peter was doubting too if we want to, because he said, no, I don't know him. No, I don't know him. And no, I do not know him. But once the Holy Ghost and fire came upon him, he knew him. And he stood up boldly and he preached a glorious message in Acts chapter 2. A bold message, and 5,000 were saved. So that's what the Holy Ghost will do with somebody that's like hiding out, afraid, scared, a denier, you know. The Holy Ghost will take that person and turn it around. And so, of course, we know Peter, he was crucified upside down because he said, I'm not worthy to die the death that my Lord and my Savior died. I'm not worthy to die like he did. So they said, okay, well, we'll turn you upside down and we'll crucify you. So all of them died a martyr's death. Not one of them does the scripture say that they died from any sickness or disease, except for John. And they tried to kill him, but they couldn't. They tried boiling him in oil. They tried putting him out on a deserted island that had no vegetation upon it. It was just kind of like rock. And he wouldn't starve. He wouldn't boil, because God had a purpose for him. And God, as long as you trust God, you believe him, you believe his word, God will keep you where he needs to keep you until you finish your course. And so John stayed around until he got done with the book of Revelation. And then I don't know how old he was when he died. And we know that Jesus said to Peter, if he lives till I come, what is it to you? So, you know, I've thought many times, I wonder if he's still alive. But of course, you know, John says he didn't say that he was going to live until he came. He said, it doesn't matter, Peter. Get your nose out of John's business. Get over here and about you, because I want you to come and follow me. I want you, if you love me, to feed my sheep. So he was dealing with Peter. But anyway, he healed all that were sick. This is God. This is Jesus. This is what Father came to do. Jesus would look upon the multitude with compassion upon them. He loved them, and he would turn away. He didn't even have time to eat. He didn't have time to rest. He would try to go into a desert place to pray and rest, and the multitude would outrun him and get there before he did. And he'd have compassion upon them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And he would minister to them and heal all of their diseases. The proof that God is in our midst. The proof that God was in their midst. And yet they plugged their ears and shut their eyes and wouldn't see. But we're going to see, and we're going to believe, and we're going to walk out the full gospel. We're going to live it out. We're going to be a light shining in a dark place. Amen. Because we're going to put the word on the inside of us. Hallelujah. That it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. See, people want to take that out. They want to take out the sicknesses. I don't know why. The church, God's people. probably because they don't live it out. And so to save their reputation so they can still be ministers in the church, you know, they want to explain that away. So we have to go and we have to look into the Word and we have to fortify ourselves, because the prince and the power of the air would try to dominate his agenda in the lives of the believer. And especially when those that come to Christ, so many of them believe that God isn't our complete deliverer. He didn't come to set us completely free from sin. They believe that he forgives us of our sins, that we are going to have past, present, and future. Plan on sinning, and God will cleanse you of your sins, the ones now and the ones you're going to commit, and just prepares you to be a sinner instead of prepares you to live out the Word of God. So we must go, and we must look into this perfect law of liberty and see what Jesus said about it. And so in Isaiah, we can go there to that scripture. Isaiah 53. He was despised and rejected, verse 3, of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And he hid, as it were, our faces from him. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs. And I looked that up, griefs. I looked it up in the Hebrew. I looked it up in the Greek when I was over there in the New Testament. You know, looked up everything. You know, you want to go back and you want to look and see what the Word of God says. You don't want to, you know, just skip on by. Surely he bore our griefs, because in Matthew it says he bore our infirmities and he bore our sicknesses. So griefs is griefs, sicknesses, and diseases when you look it up in the Hebrew. So here it is, right here. As in Matthew, as it was said, translated, infirmities and sicknesses. Here it is, what Isaiah said. It was being fulfilled at that time, that the scripture might be fulfilled. God must fulfill his word. So he's fulfilling his word now. Because he told us to go, and that's to every generation. He said, be endued with power from on high, and then go. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cast out devils, speak with new tongues. And if you drink anything, a deadly thing, it shall not hurt you. And if we're to heal the sick, raise the dead, and cast out devils out of other people, then if sickness comes against us, then we are healed in the name by the blood of Jesus Christ. We take a hold of the Word of God. We don't get discouraged by it. But we have to run, and we have to look here. We can't look at the experiences of man, but we must look at the experience of the Word. And carried away our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities, and by his stripes we were healed 2,000 years ago. So you know somebody that isn't healed? You know somebody that needs to be healed? Then you begin to claim it. You claim it over your body. You speak the word of life and you speak the word of truth. You don't speak the word of doubt and unbelief or the word of death. You speak the word of truth. You know, I've gotten a report from the doctor before. And as he was saying the report, I said, that's a lie in Jesus' name. No, I do not. That's caused by this and that and the other sins. And I'm like, I will not have that in Jesus' name. That is not going to be in my body. I will not believe it. You know, I stood there, and you know, and the doctor's trying to tell me the stuff that they know, and I got mad. And I said, absolutely not. And that's where we must stay. We must claim that over ourselves. You know, because when the enemy comes along and you get a bad toothache, and because you've been eating a lot of sugar or whatever you shouldn't been doing, you know, and that thing hurts and your body feels that pain, you're going, ah, and you know, the pain overcomes the thought of reaching out to heaven, and you're like, Dennis, quickly, this, you know, it hurts. But we can run to the Father. And it's not to say that running to the dentist is a sin or it's ungodly, but we can trust in the Lord with all of our heart and lean not to our own understanding, because all the provision for everything is right here in the Word of God. It's us taking it and applying it to ourselves. It's us looking into this perfect law of liberty and taking it and applying it for our life and living it out in every aspect, taking a hold of it. You know, I've heard preachers say, you know, I've got the anointing for this or that or the other, but when it comes to teeth, most people, teeth, for some reason, that's a tough one. Eyes are another one. If it's not blindness, then they have a tough time, you know, with the glasses part. But, you know, I keep going back to Moses. He stayed in the glory of God so much. He visited the glory of God so much that his face was not abated. That means he didn't get wrinkles, and I'm getting some. And his eyes did not grow dim. He didn't have that problem of squinting and having to get a Bible with bigger words in it. And so we want to look at the Word of God, not apply what man does and lives through and acts out. But what does the Word of God say? And I mean, my mother, she was so determined not to put on glasses. I remember her taking the newspaper and just holding it out like this. And I'm like, Mom, I think you might need a pair of glasses. Moses' face was not abated and his eyes did not grow dim. And so neither are mine. And she's 60-something years old holding that newspaper out like this so she could read it. She was determined. She was not putting those glasses on. She was not. She was going to live by the Word of God. And I don't care if that woman, if she was as sick as a person could be, where she could hardly get up. I mean, she would drag herself up. And she, you know, you'd ask her, how you doing? And she goes, I'm blessed. And, you know, one preacher boy, he said, isn't that lying? When I ask you if you're sick and you say, no, I am blessed. Isn't that lying? You're not being real with yourself. She says, I'm being real with myself. I'm speaking the Word of God. I'm not going by the seeing of the eye or the hearing of the ear or how I feel. I'm going by the Word of God, and the Word of God says I'm healed. So when she walked around for a year and a half with a big, huge cancerous tumor in her ankle and just said, I'm blessed, and she was in excruciating pain. And this was at the time that my father had a whole city block. And we had a boys' dorm and a girls' dorm and a ministry set up there. And everybody came to my mom's table to eat. And we'd have 30, 40 people at her table every night. And those families that they decided not to cook for their children that night, they could just go over to Mama Sue's and eat at her table. So, you know, that made it easy. Dinner's all cooked. Mama would do it. And then Mama would stay up to 3 o'clock in the morning washing the dishes. And sometimes she might lay down for 1 hour before she had to get up at 5 in the morning to serve out the breakfast, to serve the breakfast, prepare the breakfast for the guys that were going to work. A servant. My mother was a servant of the Lord. And here she's walking around on a cancerous tumor, and you ask her about her foot, and she says, I am blessed, I am the healed of the Lord. And she wouldn't say anything, but, you know, I heard her after she had a couple of hours of sleep go put her foot on the floor and yell out because the pain was so excruciating in her foot. But yet she would not come under the influence of even what the doctor said, because a wealthy lady that really loved my mother and loved her ministry said, you know, Sue, please, let me take you to the doctor. Let's just go get it x-rayed. So let's just go see what it is. And so they went to the doctor, and my mom never would tell anybody what that report was. She wouldn't speak it out. She's like, nope, me and Jesus. Because you know what? My mother was already on her deathbed before that. She had had a brain hemorrhage, and the blood had was, you know, when they went into her spine, to do a spinal tap, they came out and it was just pure blood in her spinal tap. She had had such a bleed in her brain. And so the doctors wanted, you know, she was incoherent all through about a month's time, I think it was. It's hard to remember all the details, but she was incoherent for about a month's time, and She couldn't remember anybody. She couldn't remember her own children. I didn't get to go see her. I was just in kindergarten or first grade, somewhere in there. And but she didn't remember my older sister, Pastor Mark. She didn't know who my dad was. She didn't know her sister. But she would preach to everyone that came into the room that the Lord knows the way through the wilderness. All you have to do is follow. She would minister to every doctor, to every nurse. And the doctors, you know, they came and they told my dad, they said, look, you know, she's in critical condition and we're going to have to operate. And when we do, we'll tie off that artery and she'll be completely paralyzed on one side. And we give her approximately about 7 years to live as long as her life stays calm and there's, you know, no major thing that happens in her life, that she should make it about 7 years, get your children a little bit older, they'll have their mother with them. And my dad cried out to the Lord and said, Lord, please do not leave me to make this decision. He said, wake her up out of this incoherency and let her hear and make this decision with me. And then my mother woke up. And my dad told her what was going on, what was wrong. And she says, okay. And she heard that day that she woke up that Oral Roberts was going to be in Bluefield, West Virginia. And she says, okay, God, I'm making an appointment with you at Bluefield, West Virginia. I am going to go there and meet with you, with your servant Oral Roberts, and you're going to heal me. And they begin to arrange that. My dad told the doctors that no, she wasn't going to have the operation, and they called him everything but anything that was something pure to say. And she began to make the arrangements to go to that meeting. They got a friend of theirs that was an ambulance driver to take her, and the doctor said she will never make it. The roughness of just the road and just moving her bed will knock that thing open again, and she will bleed to death on her way. She'll never make it there. And so she made it there. And she said it was painful every bit of the way. She hollered out with the pain every bit of the way. And they got there and put her in there on a stretcher. She couldn't, of course, get up, so she was on a stretcher. And at the end of the service, and I remember that meeting, I got to go to that. I was, you know, my mother's kids were dispersed. Some were taken. We were in Virginia. So the youngest two were taken to Ohio. I was staying with my kindergarten teacher, or first grade teacher, whichever it was. I was staying with one of the teachers. I mean, we were just all divided up and, you know, didn't half know what's going on. But at that meeting, Oral Roberts came down. He laid his hand on my mother's head, and she said, just like she felt that snap in her head, it was like a bang in her head when she felt that blood vessel burst, and it was the size of like my dad's thumbnail, which he has big hands, is what they said it was. It was a big rupture. And she said, just like she felt it burst, she felt it go back together. And the pain instantly left her body. And she went home. She was weak, but she went home in that ambulance, worshiping and shouting and praising God. And didn't go back to the hospital, but went straight home. And woke up the next morning in her own bed. And then I remember they finally came and got me. I thought they'd never pick me up. And they finally came and got me. And I remember my mom walking. She had been laying in the bed for a long time. She was pretty weak. And I remember her walking down the hallway, holding onto the wall, going, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Every step of the way, in the name of Jesus. So see, this foot thing, this cancer in the foot, was not a big deal to her. Because God had already given her life back to her. And she knew that she was in the service of the King, so she just took a hold of the promises of the Word of God. She lived them out. She walked them out. And you would not find her saying anything but, I'm blessed. I am blessed. I live and I serve the living Savior who has not only forgiven me, but He has healed my body. He is my healer. And so she would quote, of course, 1 Peter, which was taken from Isaiah, because Peter went and he read Isaiah 53, and then he was preaching, and it came out, that word that the Holy Spirit gave Isaiah come out of Peter, that same word. 1 Peter 2:24. Who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we being dead to sin, dead to sin, I'm a living sacrifice. I came to Jesus and I became a living sacrifice. My life is not my own anymore, but it is bought with a price, Jesus Christ, and I am dead to sin. And alive unto God. Hallelujah. Dead to sin should live unto righteousness. Dead to sin so we can live unto righteousness. Amen. Amen. See, if we preach it, we can live it. If we look into the perfect law of liberty and we take it in by the Holy Spirit, we can live it and we can walk it out. So we don't have to tear the pages out of our Bible. And we don't have to read the Reader's Digest for fellowship. We can read the living word of God and believe it and walk it out. Amen. Live into righteousness by whose stripes we were healed. And my mother said, do you see that word right there, were? Were? She said 2,000 years ago. You get her started. You say, Mama, now you're sick. You need to lay down. Do you see that word right there, were healed? 2,000 years ago, I was healed. Jesus healed me. 2,000 years ago, we're healed. It's past tense, so it's done, so I'm not sick. She said, let not the inhabitants of the Lord say I am sick. And has anybody ever tried to find that scripture? It's in Isaiah. Isaiah, and I'll show you, Isaiah 33, real quick. And it's talking about those that have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb that live in righteousness, and the inhabitants shall not say I am sick. She held onto the word of God and she wouldn't be moved. Hallelujah. So she imparted that into us. But every one of us, as we grow up and we grow older and we go through things, we have to take a hold of the word of God for ourselves. And so we're digging out the word of God tonight. We're looking at this perfect law of liberty and at this covenant that Father has made with us, so we can hold on to it for each and every one of our own selves. Amen. Amen. And I am expecting a healing anointing in this place. Yes. People that have had sickness and disease, and you can even take it home, and you can take it in your spirit and go lay your hands on somebody else that's sick, physically or spiritually. Get a hold of them. Get something, you know. Get something that you can put in their pillow that you pray over, that you spend time praying over. You can stick it in their pillow. You know, I've done that with my kids when I didn't think my kids were doing what they ought to be doing. I wanted to see more. I wanted to see them going deeper in the glory of heaven. I mean, I've even gone over to their houses since they got married and got into their bedroom, got a hold of their pillow. I'm like, they lay on this all night long. Let me have that thing. And I pray over it. I take some kind of oil and put it on my hands. I don't care what kind it is. I'll just put, because, you know, I'm leaving an impartation on that with that oil, and I smear it all over that pillow. My son said, Mom, is that what was on my motorcycle? And I could not ever figure out what was on my motorcycle. I said, I anointed that motorcycle from the top to the bottom. He said, I tried to figure, I cannot believe you did that. I said, you had to be safe on that thing. See, because he had wanted to buy a motorcycle for a long time. And I said, not living in San Diego, California, you're not buying a motorcycle. I didn't say that out loud. I kept saying, you got to keep a few things to yourself. And so he was like, I'm going to buy a motorcycle. I'd go into the bedroom, get on my knees. Father, I'm buying this in Jesus' name. He's not getting a motorcycle. Don't let him get insurance on that motorcycle. Don't let him be covered on that motorcycle. And, you know, and I just go after it. Because, you know, the life expectancy when you ride a motorcycle in San Diego, California on the freeway is 6 months. And so I read that. And so I'm like, my son ain't getting a motorcycle. And so one day he comes to me and he said, and this is years later, he had tried and tried to get a motorcycle. And this is years later, he comes to me and he says, Mom, stop praying that I don't get a motorcycle. And I said, he knows my prayers are effective. He knows they work. So I said, okay, son, I'll stop praying you don't get a motorcycle. You can get a motorcycle, but I'll just have to up the ante in prayer. So I'd go, he'd bring that motorcycle into my house and park it in his bedroom. Okay, that's a little weird, but he really liked his brand new motorcycle. So, I'm glad he's not here tonight. No, I'm not. I wish he was. But anyway, he loved that motorcycle. So, I'd go into his bedroom when he was gone, and I would anoint that motorcycle from top to bottom, pray protection all over that, pray protection all over his room, pray protection all over him. I'm like, he wants a motorcycle. He doesn't want me to pray. Then he doesn't get a motorcycle. So, I just got to up the ante in prayer. And so, you know, I was fine with him having that motorcycle, except for one day. I told him, he had that motorcycle for quite a while, and one day I said, are you riding that motorcycle today? And he said, yeah, why? I said, because I don't feel good about you riding that motorcycle today. Don't ride that motorcycle. And he's just like, you know, because he planned to ride the motorcycle. And so he puts on his backpack like he normally did when he's going to ride the motorcycle, and I bind it in Jesus' name, he ain't riding that motorcycle. And he goes out the door, and I'm like, he ain't riding that motorcycle. And I'm going after it. And he gets on the motorcycle. He takes off down the road. A couple minutes later, I hear that motorcycle coming right back down the road up to the house. It starts to rain. And he comes back. And he gets in his car and he goes. He couldn't get far. He knew. If I said something, because I never said, that's the only one time I said anything about that motorcycle. I will have to say, I was so thankful when he sold that motorcycle. He got it out of him. He got it all done. And it was over with. But you know what? You know, we believe God. We take a hold of God in these things. We take a hold of God with our children. And we do not let go. We win. Because we have the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost on our side. And the Lord just wants us to hook up with Him. In reality, is what it is. He wants us to hook up with Him and pray that the power of the enemy that's come out against them be broken. In Jesus' name. And that's with the life of any person. We just hook up with the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, and we don't stop. We bombard heaven till we get our way. We just bind the powers of darkness till they get sick and have to flee. They can't take it anymore. You know, we wake up in the morning, the enemy goes, oh no, there they go. They're going to pray, and we have to take off. Scared to death of us, not us. Be afraid of them. Hallelujah. When we have the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, we do not have to fear anything. The scripture says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. So even when we're passing over onto the other side, if some of us go by the grave, I'm not going for a long time. I've done decided I got to be here to pray people through. There's just not enough people that take prayer seriously. So I'm staying around till I'm so old, I'm tired of being here. Or Jesus comes first, which I'm believing He's coming soon. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm staying here to pray for people, if nothing else. If I don't preach all over the world or whatever, I can pray for people and I can see the kingdom and the glory of God fulfilled through prayer. Because I tell you what, prayer is the first part of anything you do. It's the first part. And so let's get back over here into Exodus. I want to talk a little bit. Here they were at the bitter waters of Marah. They came to the bitter waters of Marah, and they could not drink it. And, of course, they were thirsty. They'd been in the desert place. And, of course, they begin to complain and murmur. And so what does Moses do? He cries unto the Lord for the sake of the people. He cries unto the Lord, and then the Lord gives them the answer. He has them go and cut a tree branch and throw it into the water. And it became sweet. It didn't mean that it wasn't still poisonous, but they were able to drink it. Because God had the answer the whole time. And it was all about Him proving the people to see if that they would really serve Him. God's going to prove you. You're going to come to the bitter waters. You're going to come to a tough situation. And God is going to prove you. Do you love Him? Or is it just words? Do you really mean what you say? Or is it just words? Are you going to follow Him? And we'll just start in verse 25 of chapter 15. Did I tell everybody the chapter? chapter 15, verse 25. And he cried unto the Lord, and the Lord showed him a tree, which when he had cast it into the waters were made sweet. There he made for them a statue and an ordinance. There he made for them a statue and an ordinance. And there he proved them. And he said, if you will diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord your God, and will do that which is right in his sight, and will give ear to his commandments, and keep all of his statutes, I will put none of the diseases upon you which I have brought upon the Egyptians. I'm the Lord that healeth thee. I am the Lord your healer. I am the Lord that heals you. If you will keep my commandments, you see that? When we go off on our own way and get into our own mess, now I referred Wednesday night to Psalms 107, that they went off and did their own thing, and they backslid, and they got into a big mess, and then they get into trouble, because sin brings forth death, so it brings forth trouble. And when they got into the big mess, they cried unto the Lord every time. And the Lord, what did he do every time? He didn't go, I'm sick and tired of you. When they cried unto the Lord, he heard them. And he delivered them out of their trouble. And then they went and did the same thing over and over and over and over again. So, you know, God is patient and he's merciful. They knew who to cry to. They knew where the answer was. So God in his heart hoped that sometime they would come to the answer and stay there. There's a lot of people that we want to see come to the answer and stay there. I want to come to the answer and stay there. I want it to be so imparted in me, in every aspect, not just in one way, but in every aspect, that I come to the answer and I stay there, and I'm in all confidence and all boldness at all times and never let go. Because I'm tried along with you. And so what do? We go to the Word. And we walk out and we live what the Word says. We allow his Word to be imparted in us. We look at what he's done. And this is covenant. This is a covenant relationship that Father established with them. See, when he brought them out of Egypt, it was in a typification of him bringing them out of bondage, out of sin, of just like Jesus brought us out of bondage. See, what did they do? They put the blood of the lamb over the doorpost, and they took the lamb within them. They ate the lamb that night. They ate it with their shoes on in preparation of deliverance. They were prepared for the deliverance that night that they had put the blood over the doorpost, and the angel of death passed by them. Because of the blood, the angel of death could not come in and touch the firstborn of their household. Because of the blood of Jesus Christ, the power of death is broken and cannot come in. And so in this typification, they were brought out of bondage. Jesus brought us out of bondage. We're never to want to go back into bondage, back into Egypt. The people, after they get delivered out of the bondage, they want to go back in to Egypt and come under that bondage of misery that they lived in for over 400 years. It's amazing what people forget and how they can get to complaining when things don't go their way. It's just amazing. But anyway, in same typification, the being brought out in this covenant of relationship, you come through the blood. And then he baptized them, as it were, in the Red Sea, as the Red Sea parted and opened up for them. He was the deliverer. He was there, a pillar of fire at night and a cloud by day to lead them and to guide them, the Holy Spirit leading us and guiding us into all truth, to bring them into the promised land. See, we're partakers of coming in to the eternal promised land, but we are already there. We're already partakers. And he makes this covenant with them. As he's brought them out of Egypt, he's delivered them. That he is the God that delivers them, that washes away their sins, that cleanses them, that keeps covenant with them. And he is the God, their healer, if we will keep his commandments and walk in his statutes and not forget them. If we will keep him in our heart as our God, as our Lord, and as our Savior. He will keep covenant with us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. So then whatsoever we ask the Father in His name, He will give it to us because we keep His commandments. And the love of God lives and abides and dwells in us because we're obedient and we keep His commandments. Thank you, Jesus.